Okay, so today, together with Anya, we want to say something about the latest advanced machine learning time series forecasting methods. We structure our presentation in that way that I will start with some, let's say, theoretical information. I will try to be very quick, and then Anya will make a hands-on session and show, let's say, in the reality how it works. In this hands-on session, Anya will we will focus on the two methods. One is a temporal fusion transformer, currently one of the most advanced state-of-the-art method for the time series forecasting. And the second will be N-bits, and Anya will show that on the on the selected data sets. So that's the agenda. Very quickly, some review of the fundamental statistical methods for the forecasting time series. They were used for the very, very long time. The most known and famous are presented here. So it's ARMA and TARIMA, exponential smoothing, also known as a Holt Winters, different variants of Arch-Garch method, Theta method, and last method, which is maybe not a method itself, but ensemblation of the different methods. It's very important technique for the time series forecasting. This statistical method has been used for the quite a long time. There for the some time series, and they work quite well or even very good. But for some of them, they work poorly. Yeah, and the breakthrough, so the starting to the to end of the statistical method was during the M4 competition. The so-called M competition, it is a very famous competition, very prestigious one, organized by Professor Spyros Makridiakis from Nicosia University. Professor Makridiakis is a legend in the time series forecasting area. And during the M4, so fourth edition of that competition, it was won by the machine learning methods. Yeah? First and the second place were taken by the machine learning methods. And it was some kind of the breakthrough, because starting from that point, the machine learning based method dominate the time series forecasting, especially for the complex time series with the high level of noise and which are very difficult to predict. M5, so the next edition, was dominated by the machine learning methods, and currently for the difficult time series, the machine learning methods are used mostly. The first method, which I want to briefly describe, is the ES hybrid method. It is the winning method from the M4 competition. It is very innovative in at least two folds. Yeah? One is the usage of the very original neural networks architecture. It was based on the LSTM neural networks, but with the residual connection, dilatation, and attention. And the second very innovative feature was the ability to train both the neural network and transformation parameters in the one backpropagation process. And also this method uses ensembling for a quite significant scale with the very good results. Here we see this innovative architecture of the neural network. So it was the LSTM network, but with the residual connection, which were rather known, at least at that time, for the convolutional neural network and image processing, but it was very successfully used here. And also the attention has been introduced. the second method is the n-bit methods. Anya will also show that that method in works. This method was not used in the for competition, but claims to have a better results on the same data sets. And it's fully machine learning models based on the very generic neural network architecture. Innovative things are the different type of the blocks with the trends, seasonality, and so-called generic blocks, and advanced usage of ensemble, even on the higher scale than for the ES hybrid. Also, some kind of the ensembling is built into the network, so the prediction from each stack are gained together. Yeah, so we have the additional level of the forecasting. Third framework, rather, because it's not the one method, but it's a complete ready-to-use framework, is Gluon TS. Yeah? The first two methods, ES hybrid and NBITS, are available as a PyTorch or a TensorFlow code, but Gluon TS is a complete framework, complete library with the various models, various methods for the data transformation, probabilistic time series modeling, and it's ready to use and provide very good results. Also, Gluon TS is ready for the cloud computing training and inference, and available even as a service provided by some cloud providers, and has very strong community support. That is the more or less overview of the elements of the Gluon TS framework. More description are available on the Gluon TS website. And the last method, which I want to mention here, is Tsetlin machine, and or rather usage Tsetlin machine for the time series forecasting. Tsetlin machines are based on the stochastic learning automata, and it's also very innovative approach to the time series forecasting, which is especially useful for the data with the high level noise to signal. And stochastic learning automata algorithms was invented by the Russian scientist called Tsetlin in the 60s of previous century. So it's quite old, but the application to the time series forecasting is very new. And in the very nutshell, in opposition to the neural networks, which are after training very deterministic, so each neural networks for the same input data, the prediction is the same for the Tsetlin machine, and algorithm learns the probability distribution and samples this probability distribution for the input data. So the results are stochastic, yeah, because they are sampled from the distribution of each pattern. And but the algorithm can learn that distribution. So it's a very different approach, but very innovative. That's all about the methods. Very briefly summary. Okay, so, and if I ask Sergey about letting Anya in, because Anya is reconnecting, so please let Anya in. And we will switch to Anya. Okay, and I will continue with the summary. Most important thing is that there is a very, very dynamic development of the new methods. The efficiency of the machine learning model is significantly higher than for the statistical methods. There are, of course, many areas to use the time series forecasting, especially on the time series with the high noise. And in for the financials time series, like predictions, the price of the financial assets, it is possible to achieve the long-term accuracy over 60%, which is not possible with the typical statistical method. Yeah, so this better forecasting gives a significant edge in the many areas. Okay, and now time for the hands-on session by Ania.
Okay, very good. Okay, so after the theoretical introduction, I would like to show something practical. I would like to present how we struggle with time series on a daily basis. So I will talk shortly about the whole process, starting from the data pre-processing, models choice, models evaluation, boosting accuracy, and explainable AI, which can be used with the time series data. To have some real examples, I will show a short demo. We've discussed steps for making modern time series machine learning work and what could be done to push this technique further. To have some real examples, so I chose a publicly available data set. The selection criteria were multidimensionality, difficulty, and data size. And I will briefly show what can be done with such data. Those are not financial data, but I chose them because they are more understandable and good for the demo purposes. So as I mentioned before, these data are open sourced. There is around 40,000 of rows, each for one timestamp. Frequency of this data is 1 hour. We have around 15 columns, 6 main air pollutants, 6 connected with weather, and the rest express the date. Here we have some example columns plotted. As we can see, data look messy. After zooming data plots, it looks slightly better. After aggregation, example over, I don't know, a week maybe, we can see some regularities. And normally we would do some explanatory data analysis, etc. However, we don't have as much time. So we will focus only on parts which are absolutely necessary, which are crucial for modeling. And this is the head of our data frame with our data. And the first thing which needs to be done is handling the missing data. Okay, so firstly, we need to understand the source of missingness. Does it occur regularly? What are the largest gaps between consecutive not missing values? Here I have plotted some basic missing data statistics, starting from basic bar plot. As we can see here, many columns do not contain any nonce, but there exist columns with significant amount of missing values, such as carbon monoxide here. Next, heat map help us determine which occurrences of nonce in different columns are correlated. And we can see a strong correlation of columns describing the weather, such as pressure and temperature here. And correlation of occurrences of missing values in different columns can be maybe also expressed with dendrogram. And apart from basic statistics and correlations, we can check the distribution for specific columns. So we can select the column. And here we have length of consecutive nonce histogram. So as we can see in this example for carbon monoxide, most of the consecutive nonce sequences are short, but also series of missing values as long as consecutive missing values as long as 60 also exist. And the right plot shows the length of gaps between missing values. So if it was a straight line, that would mean that nonce occur regularly. They do not in this case. So now we need to handle this missing data. So we could apply standard basic methods like backward filling, linear or polynomial imputation, we could also use more advanced methods based on machine learning models. Here we have here we have examples of missing value imputation with these very standard methods. For example, I can for visualization purposes, I can artificially increase the number of missing nests here. And we can see how different methods handles, simple methods handles this missing data, starting, for example, from forward filling. For example, spline with the higher order, which will give us a smoother curve. Like this. Okay. But as we from the nonce statistics, we know that some of the lengths of some of the consecutive nonce series is very large, like in this case, and in that case, it's hard to guess what should be there. We will not impute anything values here. We will just split this series into two series, like in this example. Okay, so second things which needs to be done are data transformations. This step is crucial for some statistical models which require often series in specific format, for example, stationary. For more advanced models is often not essential, but might help with numerical issues. And here we have listed some basic transformations which can be applied for time series. And we can see how our series would look after the given transformation. For example, okay, like in this example. And we can also use more advanced transformation, like for example, we can like embeddings obtained with many different methods. And another example of interesting transformation are time transformations, which are often very important in time series forecasting. An example of simple but effective time series transformation is encoding cyclical features like hours, days, etc. into unit circle, like in the presented GIF. So here are, for example, number of days, and these are encoded days into unit circle. Okay, so now we move to modeling part. For modeling, we will choose one column, nitrogen dioxide, and prediction horizon equal to 6, so 6 hours. And we will normalize features. Sometimes we will use Box-Cox transformations, but only for classical machine learning methods, and encode cyclical features, in our case hours, into unit circle. Okay, and first we will train baselines and simpler statistical models to have some point of reference, and then we will move to neural networks methods. And few words about the training setup. We will use train validation and test split. And for evaluation, we'll use rolling window. And here we have plotted train validation and test splits. And we will start with extremely simple models, naive predictors. It's good to always look at them in time series forecasting because they are very easy to use. And it often happens that the metrics of our model, trained model, graphs, results, statistics, look okay at the first glance, but then it turns out that the naive predictions is better and our model is actually worthless. And the alternative to these naive predictions, which is worth to mention, is a usage of metrics called mean absolute scaled error. And for classical models, you would use SARIMA. In this case, SARIMA, because the data are probably seasonal, PROFET, TBATS, or exponential smoothing. And these methods should be fine-tuned with rolling window, with hyperparameter grid search, or Bayesian base hyperparameter search if our search hyperparameter search space is very large. And as we have seasonal data, probably seasonal data, we will use two naive predictors, last value repetition and repetition of values from the previous day with the same hour. And here are the results of these two naive predictors. We will compare them later with other methods. Here are the basic metrics which can be used for a regression problem. Okay, and normally now we would train statistical baselines like Sarima, Kibat, etc., but we don't have enough time to discuss all of them. And I would like to spend more time on advanced time series methods. So I will just skip this part. And for advanced neural networks methods, two methods were chosen, temporal fusion transformer and NBIS. Both of them are state-of-the-art models. They have different advantages and complement each other very well. In this picture, we can see a temporal fusion transformer architecture. As you can see, it's quite complicated, but we will not talk about the technical details. We will focus only on advantages of this model. So first of all, good results according to the paper, comparing to statistical and neural networks models methods. It works with multivariate series with different types of data. So it works with both categorical continuous or static variables. It has implemented variable selection network. It's interpretable thanks to attention layer. It works with known feature inputs, and that allows, for example, us creating conditional predictions. And in general, it's applicable without modification to wide range of problems, and we can obtain some, and the predictions are also explainable. And the other method, advanced method, is NBIS. NBIS outperformed the winner model from prestigious M4 competition. It means that it achieved the best scores on 100,000 univariate time series from different domains. So it's a badge of quality. It's optimized for univariate time series. Its results are also interpretable. It's thanks to special models which are designed to express trend and seasonality. And to sum up, TFT and NBIS both have a very good scores and try to deliver interpretable predictions, but are optimized for different types of data. NBIS is optimized for univariate time series, and the big advantage of TFT is ability of handling multivariate time series with mixed data type. And for a training of this neural network, we use some like early stopping, learning rate scheduler, and gradient clipping. And sometimes, but not in this case, we also use Bayesian-based framework for choosing the best like hidden input size, etc. Okay, so now let's move to the results. Here are plotted NBIS results. So the accurate matrix results will be presented later in the table. Here is just a GIF for NBIS performance on the test set. This is the test set. This gray rectangle represents the prediction horizon. So its width is equal to 6 because the horizon was 6 hours. And the same GIF. The same GIF was delivered for TFT model. So data are noisy, but predictions sometimes look okay. Model often correctly predicts future forecast direction. Here are some predictions from TFT, from test set, which are actually very good. I swear that these predictions were selected randomly, but I was very lucky because all of them looks better than, for example, some of the predictions in this GIF. And apart from the predictions here, the orange line, we can also see attention values. So the higher values here, it means that the more important was that timestamp during the prediction. Okay, so here we have table with different experiments with TFT and N bits. This method, the only difference between these experiments was the loss function. And as we can see, comparing to our naive predictors, which were there. Okay, there. Like the neural networks significantly overperformed these naive predictions. The improvement is very huge. And as you can see, temporal Fourier transformers with quantile loss scored the best. It's probably because the NBIS was trained as a univariate time series, on univariate time series, and the TFT models also took as an input another columns like another air pollutant or these columns expressing the date. And the next question is, can we do better? And of course, we can try to optimize hyperparameters of our network architectures, etc. It will take a lot of time, but there is one thing which requires less time and is extremely effective, it's ensembling. And even models with the same architecture, exactly the same architecture, trained with different loss functions, can give us a huge improvement in ensembling. And here we have a proof. These experiments with TFT and NBIS are differing only in loss function. And even the simplest possible ensemble, so naive ensemble, so mean, taking a mean of prediction, can significantly boost our score. So for example, okay, so here we have improvement already. Oh, and now this improvement is significant. It's over two. It's 1.5. The best naive ensembler give us improvement over 15% over the single models. And what's interesting, even models with low score, like TFT with delayed loss, which has the worst scores across all of the models, across all of the TFT models, contributes positively to in model ensembling. So all of the methods, all of the TFT methods with the delayed loss scores better than all of the TFT methods without these experiments with delayed loss. Okay, so as I mentioned, both TFT and NBIS aim to give explainable predictions, and here we have results obtained from TFT. First plot shows the values importance in time. So the higher is the value here, the more important was the time during predictions. And in this case, the most influential data were measured 168 hours, so 7 days before the prediction time. So it means that we can have a weak seasonality here. And here we have features importance from variable selection model. And it's not surprising that the most important feature was the target feature here, and the decoder variable importance for future known values, like those connected with time. So the features which are known in future. So here is the most important values here was hour. And with small modification of architecture, we can also see with which features were the most important for specific timestamp. So as I mentioned, to obtain such results, we need to slightly change architecture. We need to slightly change these values in this explainable attention layer. So there is no guarantee that the model will work as good as the original on any type of data, etc. But for some examples, it also worked good. So for example, in this case, with this architecture change in last layer, we can see which in TFT, which model's features were important for which timestamp during the prediction. As we can see, these values here change. Here, for example, our target predictions. So this is end of my demo. To sum up, model time series models can give a satisfying results with even very simple preparation. And for each step of the whole process, starting from the data imputations, transformation, hyperparameter optimization, or model assimilations, many improved techniques were found. But even with these simple techniques, we can make it work.